Hello everyone, welcome to Tarmak Talking. This is Anantha Krishnan here. In this new edition, we are getting you an inspiring story of Radel. Hello.
Hi Anant.
Yeah.
Welcome to Radel.
A very small aerospace and defense company in Bangalore's electronic city. In the last 13 years, Radel has contributed immensely for India's various aerospace and defense programs. To name a few, they have developed distributors for Jaguar, auto selectors for Jaguar, electronic frequency synthesizers, and a very crucial frequency synthesizer of 2 GHz for MiG-29, fuel flow meter test jig for the Su-30s, anti-collision light for a series of aircraft, and most importantly, the terrain avoidance warning system, TOS, and warning panel and relay box for the N-32, and also insulation designed for LRUs of LCA and ALH. Many more projects done by a very small team, just around 70 people. What makes Radel special? Just 70 small team also does another inspiring work supporting India's music industry. And in fact, music has been Radel's first mission, which was started 4 decades back. Its captain Raj Narayan, who is turning 70 very soon, has been pioneering in developing electronic Shruti boxes supporting musicians. So we'll also get to hear that side of the story. We're trying to get in new elements to Tarmak Talking. Sit back and enjoy. Very interesting story of Radel. And also a very inspiring story of Raj Narayan.
Thank you.
I must tell you that, you know, I was speaking to one of your batchmates of HAL, who was there with you for the interview in 1969.
Yes, that's
correct?
Right. That's right.
So we found out that during that interview, you apparently went for the interview with a bag. Mm. And this bag contained aircraft models, 2 or 3 aircraft models, and you surprised the interview panel saying that, you know, look at the kind of things I've already done, those models. And it also had MiG-21 model. I haven't heard this story before. Somebody has gone with a bag full of planes. What prompted you first, I would want to know, and what was the reaction of the people who were interviewing you?
See, we moved to Bangalore in 1959, and I was a kid of just about 10 years old. And those days, every day I used to see vampires flying in the sky. So those were days when we used to see a lot of air activity over the city. Aeronautics automatically fascinated me. So all the time I used to be observing and watching aircraft, and then automatically I started getting interested. And I used to go to British Council library and borrow flight magazines, go through each and every article, including those cutaway drawings. So I got exposed and went fairly deep into aircraft structures, aircraft propulsion systems, various airborne systems. So I got very passionately involved. And that's how I started making scaled models. So I used to make these, and I was a fairly good accomplished carpenter even then. So I used to make these scale models from the three-view drawings I found in flight magazines.
So what happened when you took the bag out and...
Yeah, they were quite surprised because this was scale model with the minutest of details of the HF-24. HF-24 model was about almost a foot long. Then I had the BAC-111 model made out of...
This British Aerospace Corporation then?
Yes. It was completely to scale with steel GI sheet made wings, center fuselage, and then the nose cone made of wood, tail made of wood. So there was a lot of things that I had absorbed by looking at the cutaway drawings in flight.
Interesting. So what happened when you told them that you have to give me a job? I have already made planes.
I'm quite sure any employer would appreciate the passion in the sector, in the field in which he wants to work. They found that I was smart enough to be absorbed in the organization.
How old were you then?
I was just about 19 and a half.
Your love affair with HAL only lasted for a decade. And then the entrepreneur in Raj took birth.
Yes.
And very interesting to know that you have named it after your wife.
That's right.
Radhika Electronics.
That's
that
right.
is what
Radel stands for.
Radel stands for.
Yes.
So let us hear about those initial years of forming Radel.
When I was absorbed into the design at HAL, we were exposed to cutting edge technologies of that period. You know, we started working with ICs, and then the exposure to high reliability design and high-tech systems on board an aircraft. And the first project I worked on was the cockpit simulator. It was called the procedure trainer for the Kiran, to train pilots on the ground and get them familiar with the cockpit layout and the various systems. So we had to actually convert physical instruments like an altimeter, airspeed indicator, etc., and put servo motors inside it and then run them using various circuits that we designed, and to make it appear as if he was actually flying the aircraft. Right from engine starting, I was involved in simulation of the sound inside the cockpit. So the jet engine starting. So I had already a passion not only for aerospace but also in audio.
All right.
So I combined these two to successfully develop the audio simulation in that procedure trainer project. I was also involved in some of the instrument simulations, etc. So that gave me an exposure to a hardcore electronic design and also a little bit of mechatronic design.
So being an MSME, supporting India's aerospace defense programs, whomever I have talked to, you know, it's very tough for most of the companies to sustain because of various reasons.
Yes, yes.
So is it this music part that's helping you out?
It is. Let me go back to when I started as an entrepreneur. So the first opportunity as an entrepreneur was to do something for BHEL. They were making these energy meters and they had a lot of components, and that's when their order books were swelling up. I had captured an order for making some wound potential coils, which goes into as a part into the energy meters.
All right.
So that was again the jobbing operation which I started. So it gave me something to sustain. And then I developed that business. Went into, even with my background in electronics, I designed test equipment for testing those wound components which others didn't have. So I demonstrated my competence in manufacturing and delivering quality products to BHEL. That built up my confidence, and parallelly, as I was also a performing musician by then, I needed the support of musical instruments like a tanpura or a shruti box to practice at home. So I said, with my electronics background and design expertise, can I develop some product to help me practice independently? So that's how I developed an electronic shruti box, and that led to electronic tambura and an electronic tabla, which grew as an industry, and that is what is today my bread and butter.
All right.
And that is what is sustaining my activity, the other passion in aerospace.
So you are a trained musician, you are a flautist, isn't
Absolutely,
it?
Yes. I have performed at the national level.
So can we just go around and see some of those musical support equipment that you have?
Sure.
So this is your dream laboratory, I would say the musical laboratory where all your first love, and you have created so many products. So why don't you explain to me some of these?
These, you have a whole range of musical instruments, basically comprising electronic tanpuras, electronic tablas, electronic veena, electronic swarmandal, etc. And I started developing these as I saw the benefit of using electronics and technology to get over some of the deficiencies in the traditional instrument.
All right.
So just to run through this in very quickly, this is an artistic looking tanpura, but still the sound comes from electronic circuits.
All right.
So it can play by itself, or I can make it simulate a touch as anybody would play a traditional tanpura.
So it's really amazing to see.
It's a mix of the tradition and the technology.
Okay.
So this is a tabla. Again, this is a
tabla.
Current generation electronic tabla. The tabla was basically developed by me because the North Indian musicians need tabla accompaniment even when they are singing for practice at home. It plays by itself. So now it can play different tals at different tempos,
all right,
different pitch. So it enables the musician to practice for as long as he wants.
So can we go to the higher pitch for this?
Yes.
And a little more faster.
Yes. Then it can also do a little bit of, you know, simulation of real life accompaniment.
Okay.
We have two keys called fill-in.
Brilliant. Great.
So a musician feels as if he's getting a live accompaniment.
And then we come over to...
Then there's a swarmandal where you have the sound. This is very similar to a traditional instrument, except that the sound is coming from electronic circuits.
Okay.
And not the actual strings.
Very interesting to go around and see that side of the passion. I have attended a couple of your talks, you know, including the, you know, most unforgettable speech where you gave at Indian Science Congress in Mysore. And from there on, you know, I have noticed your, you know, various, you know, been just following you. You have been, I can say, some kind of a voice of MSMEs in India. And been very strong with your views when it came to matters of the needs and desires and concerns of MSMEs. Last couple of years, you know, Make in India has become a slogan. There has been a lot of emphasis being given. So I would want to know, how do you rate this Make in India mission? Has all the concerns of MSMEs addressed? Because today you have a music industry parallel running, supporting your aerospace mission. Otherwise, it would have been maybe difficult, isn't it?
Yes.
So, as an early bird, much before this Make in India all came, I would want to hear from you, what is that MSMEs feel?
Mm. Mm.
Have they been, you know, because we keep hearing hand-holding
yes.
every time.
Yes.
So, what's the truth? What's the reality?
See, Make in India can be broken into manufacturing or even design and manufacturing in the general purpose, that is, general industry. Whether it's automobiles or scooters, two-wheelers, etc., etc. But we are, I think, talking more with reference to the aerospace and defence.
Yes.
And there have been a lot of enthusiasm. At the same time, I think a lot of people have got a little disappointed with the lack of progress and lack of nurturing and support that is absolutely required when you want to address a very, very specialized and niche segments such as aerospace and defense. Actually, we are talking about military aerospace. So military aerospace is a very demanding field. And since for the last 5 or 6 decades, it has been restricted behind closed doors of a defense DPSU.
Or DRDO or whatever.
DRDO or whatever it is. The private sector outside this domain have not been exposed to the very specialized technologies involved in defense aerospace. So, without a background and a domain expertise, it's difficult for MSMEs to jump into it and then perform whatever you expect them to perform. It's a challenge. So, I have strongly been advocating the fact that you need to hold hands. DPSU should be able to hold hands with the private sector, whether it's small, medium or large, and transfer the domain expertise, work with them and then nurture them to grow up the value chain. If that doesn't happen, MSMEs cannot sustain, because to meet the reliability standards and the qualification requirements, certification requirements is no easy joke. So if you don't nurture them, then they are going to spend money, fail and then run away.
So is it a sad story for MSMEs linked to aerospace and defense now, or things have improved, or the stalemate still continues, or more needs to be done? Definitely more needs to be done.
I definitely feel that more needs to be done.
So what are the two things you as a domain expert, somebody who has been there, what do you feel that, what are the two, three things MSMEs require immediately so that, you know, they can become key players in India's aerospace and defense sector?
See, if I talk only from the point of view of my company, where I and my colleague are two people with more than 4 to 5 decades of aerospace involvement, a very, very deep involvement in design and manufacturing, and well exposed to all the technologies. We are completely unique because We know the platform, we know the systems in depth, and when from that point of view, we can reverse engineer and produce the LRUs, whether it's avionics or hydraulics or whatever it is. It's difficult to imagine any other MSME having this kind of a domain expertise with hands-on exposure on design and then overseeing prototype, overseeing flight testing, and then you know going to production stage. So that would be the limitation for any other generic MSME, which we have overcome because of our platform experience. So if you look at it from the point of view of a generic MSME, he might be having a specialized hydraulic experience catering to industry, general purpose industry. But when it comes to hydraulics on an aerospace, the question of qualifying to mil standards or JSS Penta 5 and meeting all the reliability standards, et cetera, that is something that he would not be exposed to. And that's where a DPSU or a DRDO needs to handhold. And you must have some kind of a training or an induction process, just as you would induct a fresh employee into an organization, such as HAL or VEL or anywhere. Here you must have an induction program for inducting an MSME into the domain.
Interesting thought. You also have an induction program for your engineers.
Yes.
Here.
Yes.
That is one of the sessions I remember I attended a couple of years back.
Yes.
So it's called Drona, right?
Right.
So
yeah.
Drona
Center
refurbishes
yeah.
a fresh engineer.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So I remember you saying that today's engineers can't talk.
Yes.
I remember you saying that today's engineers, because there are too many engineers coming
yes.
out, you know.
Yes.
So this Drona is a concept you came out with.
Absolutely. Yes.
And then here, fresh recruits are taught to unlearn.
I'll put it in a slightly different way. You see, I hate to say this, but most graduates, the general statement made by many employers and institutions is that today's engineers are unemployable. Now, I wanted to prove that that's wrong. Whatever is the deficiency in the education system, that's a different matter. That needs to be addressed independently. But from an industry point of view, if the industry is able to give them the correct induction program, which also includes a certain amount of training and exposure to the particular domain, they can churn out wonders, and that's what we have proven. Whatever 6 or 7 airborne LRUs that we have indigenized, we have not copied a foreign LRU. We have stripped out the equipment, captured the input-output specifications, and then re-engineered using current technology, using the presently available integrated circuits and technologies that are well known, and given them a product that meets a form-fit function equivalent.
So, small company, great philosophy, tons of passion. So, just this Drona, your institute, they make engineers to mil standards?
Absolutely. It boils down to that. So where we are able to teach them refocus on the practical application of the theory that they studied. That is what is missing in an engineering college. So here we tell them start from foundations, but we don't do carry out lectures. It's hands-on, saying, okay, this is the theory that you learned here. Now you see how it actually works on a breadboard or in a circuit. And then you relate to the theory, you understand it better.
2005 to 2018, 13 years, and in this span, close to 20 different products.
Yes, more than that. Projects.
Projects.
These include the airborne LRUs as well as ground test jigs, which also we have designed right from scratch.
So when I look at the, your profile, it's virtually every platform is there.
Yes.
So a lot of work being done on the Jaguar,
yes.
and you have done work on the Kirin's, you've done on an amazing thing on AN-32 and then on the Su-30.
And MiG-29.
And so that MiG-29 is something which I want to know because,
yes.
And then again on LCA, and so different,
yes.
different platforms.
Yes.
And even to some work, even for the Indian Army, for the,
yes.
for
the missile launcher.
For the missile launcher. So virtually all the three forces are
yes.
there, and
yes.
Air Force takes a bigger share of your work. So MiG-29 sounds like a very critical work
yes.
to reach.
Yes.
So could you please explain, what was that?
This is a frequency synthesizer module that goes into the local oscillator of the fire control radar on the MiG-29. So this was giving them repeated problems with failures, and with the fire control radar not working, the aircraft is as good as not a fighting machine.
All right, okay.
So they wanted to indigenize that. And in 2014, we were able to win this tender. This was again domain where we had not explored. This is what I have been doing. Every time I try to extend my boundary, if I have worked till one particular boundary, then I take a more challenging project that extends my boundary a little further. So from low frequency, we went into a HF synthesizer in the HF band. Once we successfully did that, we said, okay, we can perhaps take up even up to 2 gigahertz. So this is a 2 gigahertz digital frequency synthesizer we designed from scratch to replace an analog synthesizer in the Russian model. And that we did perfectly, and just 3 weeks ago, it's flown in a MiG-29 after a complete qualification testing, environmental testing, etc. So it's now a proven product.
Whoever I've spoken to over the years, especially the small players and supporting India's defense needs, I'm being told that you need to have tons of patience to be in this game.
Absolutely.
It's, you know, you need different skills to stay afloat.
Yes.
Because the numbers are very small.
Correct.
And even you might have given the best product, best in the world, there is no guarantee that you will get more orders, what we call it as a repeat orders. So what is your advice to a young entrepreneur who is warming up to become, you know, an MSME supporting India's defense? What are the couple of things he or she needs to keep in mind so that his entry is smooth?
There are a few things that I have been emphasizing. The fact that we have excellent brains in this country. In fact, we really shouldn't be having unemployable engineers. So we need to have a system where these engineers are properly trained, properly exposed, and that's where the skill training comes in. And I've been very passionate in skill training, right from technicians to diploma engineers to graduate engineers. So once you have a system of properly training and educating your engineers, I think anything is possible in this country. Drona falls in that. We don't really need to import. And to that end, I appreciate Prime Minister Narendra Modi's philosophy of Make in India. And I go to the extent of saying it's not just manufacture in India, design, manufacture, and support the entire life cycle of any product. But having said that, aerospace and defense in particular is not really a sector where you can get large volumes of business. So for an MSME to get into this, the MSME has to first specialize and create a parallel revenue stream that meets general purpose industry, whether it's in an industrial application or a consumer product, and then with a foundation where he is not struggling for his day-to-day bread and butter, then he can venture into a very specialized field where then he gets exposed to high reliability design and high technology, which he can again flow it back into his industrial product or a consumer product.
So, okay, that's a very interesting take. This alone might not be enough.
Absolutely.
You
it
might,
cannot.
You might hit a dead wall.
Yes.
So you need
yes.
to have different options.
Yes. Yes.
So, you know, the typical Radel story.
Yes.
Where you started with music instruments, then that expertise you transformed to aerospace defense. Yeah. Then the aerospace defense depth of technology, it also helped to better,
correct.
You know?
Correct.
So it has to be a mix.
Actually, I would put it slightly roundabout. The musical instruments that I developed was developed because of my exposure to high-tech electronics and high-tech systems in HAL. So using that knowledge to develop the musical instruments and using the knowledge of how to design for reliability and maintenance and so on in a musical instrument and building up that industry to a sustainable level where I was able to say, okay, part of the returns, I flow back into an aerospace sector. And so it's a win-win situation in both sectors. So I have an infrastructure that is shared between the two companies. I have manpower which is shared. I have knowledge which is shared. So both sectors win. Both sectors grow. And I think that's the model that MSMEs have to look at.
So just having an oven which only bakes cake won't do.
Yes.
So this. So
yes.
You should also be baking different things.
Absolutely.
So how do you keep yourself inspired all the time?
See, I believe in positive energy. And that all my life, I have never looked at anything negatively. So if there is something that I don't like, then I look for something else which can give me positive energy and positivity. So I have been always trying to look at challenges all my life, whether I was a kid or in my college or in my HAL or subsequently. If there is something that I can improve, then I take it up as a challenge and say, okay, let me find a better solution to solve this problem. And that's how all these musical instruments were born. That's how even in the aerospace sector, I'm looking at the challenge of providing an Indian solution, completely 100% Indian solution, to get rid of an obsolescence issue or an issue of non-availability of something from a foreign vendor. And that's where I try to even convey that positivity to my engineers, and that's how we all start working together.
Maybe the viewers would also like to see some of your, you know, the products from very close quarters.
So these are only some of the products that we have indigenized and developed for the Air Force, Army and Navy. So for example, this is a synthesizer which goes into a manpack transceiver of the Air Force. Okay. And this is the most challenging project that I was talking about. This is the frequency synthesizer which goes into the fire control radar of the MiG-29. An LED-based landing light that we are developing for the Kiran. This is an LED-based anti-collision light. Okay. Absolutely no moving parts in this. This has been developed for the AN-32, but we can adapt this for any aircraft. Right. So this is again a prestigious project. It's a part of a fuel flow test jig for the Su-30, which okay. we developed and designed, delivered to HAL, Lucknow. These two are again the armament-related control units. This releases bombs on the Jaguar pylons. Okay. So it can fire up to 4 ERUs on the pylon and drops the bombs.
So a lot of work seems to be have happened on Jaguars.
This is the, these two are the Jaguar LRUs.
Okay,
all
right.
This is the distributor that goes into the Matra pod to fire the, it actually provides the ignition impulse to fire the rockets in the pod. And these are again AN-32 control panel, the terrain avoidance warning panel, which goes into the cockpit of the AN-32. Completely indigenous version that we have developed. And this is the terrain avoidance warning system, the relay box, which has been completely indigenized. So these, all three of the AN-32 have been qualified and certified. Jaguar have been qualified and certified. So we are now looking forward to getting into production, serial production. That has to happen. Otherwise, this won't be well worth the development effort that has gone into it.
So again, it goes back to the MSME concern or the MSME wish that serial production, numbers.
Yes.
Right.
And there's one more thing that I think I would try to highlight. If some MSME has developed a technology for one platform, and if the same technology can be adopted to various other platforms, be it aircraft or even ships or tanks, that needs to happen, and it should happen without going through a separate RFQ and a separate bidding system, because it's not a question of large volumes going to different people. You have small volumes, and you have to split those small volumes into three or four vendors also defeats the whole purpose of indigenization. So Anand, this is the one of the R&D teams working on various aerospace as well as the musical instruments projects. So we do development work, design and development of software, electronic circuits, mechanical design, everything.
So it's a sort of mix of music and aerospace and you know.
And every engineer gets to work on software as well as hardware of both kind of products, the aerospace defense as well as musical instruments. So they get a very good mix of the approach to designing and developing a product for a particular application.
Interesting, very interesting.
So we'll get into the details of some of the projects here. So this is Mahindra, the engineer who's worked on some of the military projects as well as some of the musical instruments.
Hi Mahindra, so how is being your Radel experience?
It's an immense learning opportunity. We get to work on a platform end to end, any product in the aerospace sector. So interacting with all the different departments, it's a really good learning experience.
So what are the military projects, you know, if you could just say one of the projects what you worked on?
I worked on the indigenization of a rocket launcher. Anti-tank guided missile used by the Indian Army, qualified and expecting production. completely delivered.
All right. Okay. All the best.
Thank you, sir. And you'd be surprised, sir, that I'm also following Tarmak.
Okay.
For
Tarmak
the last 2 years.
Fans.
Yes.
Oh, that's a big surprise. Yeah. Okay. All right. So how is it? Good, bad, ugly?
Very good, actually.
Hi.
Hi, sir.
So you are
Vishnu, sir.
Vishnu. Oh, nice name. So on like what's the project you are in now?
Frequency synthesizer, sir.
Okay. For which platform?
This is for MiG-29, which is a part of a radar.
Okay.
They used to locate the target around the
okay, target location. Interestingly. Yes, so how has been your experience being part of Radel?
It was challenging. We got a lot of opportunity to work on a real-time project. We were independently working on project, both hardware and software we'd be working on.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
So you are?
Anita.
Anita, okay. So Anita, so what do you do here?
I am working in a electronic harmonium.
Okay. Which is the first electronic harmonium ever developed in the country.
Oh, okay. Okay. So she is on this project. Yeah. You know, so when will you finish this in the sense?
Hopefully in the next 6 months, we will launch it into the market.
Okay, great, Anita. So you should be very proud of, you know, you're going to be in the news in the next 6 months. So
yes.
How is the company? What's your experience?
Radel is a stepping stone to my career after my graduation, and it's a great learning opportunity.
All right, great learning opportunity. All the best.
Thank you.
There are a lot of interesting things from Radel, very inspiring bits, aerospace, defense, music. So we have kept a surprise element, a surprise package for you. Here we go, and let's find out more. Here is the lady behind the successful man, as they say, Radhika Madam. And Radel Group, when I was speaking to the employees today, they all say that she is a mentor to them. So straight away to you, how has been the journey with Raj Narayan? How has been the journey with the young and inspiring team of Radel? And you know, because I understand from my conversation over the years with different people in the industry that you know, you have played a very, very pivotal role in this dual mission of aerospace technologies and music.
So the journey has been just amazing. It's one long journey of learning everything, because I'm neither an electronics person nor am I an entrepreneur, and to start both at the same time was something extraordinary. I had to then start learning how to run an industry, however small it was at that time. So I learned on the job, making mistakes, falling down, getting up, how to run an industry, how to manage people, how to manage the staff.
So all of these have come, and finally a series of aerospace successful projects.
Those projects actually are more, you know, towards the technical side.
Technical side, and those also have inspired these.
Absolutely.
Isn't it?
Yes.
So this is an electronic, this is a digital, what is this?
This is a digital Veena. It is a, actually it is a Veena synthesizer.
Veena synthesizer. All
so
right.
It synthesizes the sound of a Veena, very similar to how a keyboard synthesizes the sound of a piano.
So I remember Raj telling me in the morning, this has got a patent, right?
Yes.
So India's,
yes.
What is that?
It's the first ever patent for an Indian electronic musical instrument.
Oh, that's great. So Raj, did aerospace technology influence the...
Absolutely. There has been a lot of transfer and cross-pollination of ideas and technologies between the aerospace company and the musical instruments company. Engineers working on some new technology in the aerospace sector apply that to realizing a musical instrument, even vice versa. Some coding that they have done for a musical instrument sometimes strangely finds an application in an aerospace gadget, in an LRU. So this has been the one of the most fascinating and amazing things in this company, because we are having such two extremely diverse domains, and yet same people are working on both these.
Interesting cross-pollination of ideas, technology. So let's you know, it's been a long day.
Yeah.
Sign it off with, you know, I can't say let's begin the party, but the fact is maybe a small musical session.
Sure.
So what is that you guys are going to play?
What would you like to hear?
Maybe Balamurli's Tilana.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
That'll be nice. That'll be nice.
Yes.
Amazing. I feel, you know, music is much more inspiring than chasing aerospace and defense stories, isn't it? And I wish this show could have just went on for a long time. Brilliant. Thank you so much, Raji and Radhika ji.
My pleasure.
It has been a different kind of tarmac talking. A great marriage of technology and music. That's the story of Radel. I'm sure all of you would have enjoyed this. Until we meet next time. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
So it has been a very, very inspiring day meeting those young engineers and designers of Radel in Bangalore. You know, very rare mix of aerospace and music, which I haven't seen, at least as a journalist. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, Raj. You have been very inspiring. And this is a small token of love from